Hi. In my last video, I gave an overview of time series data. I generally touched upon use cases of time series. What are the components of time series? In this video, I'm going to dive detail into data analysis of time series data. Data analysis is very key in time series data. There are multiple factors to it, and off of time series of problem can be solved by proper data analysis. And when I talk about data analysis, these are both statistical techniques as well as exploratory data analysis, and it is used to find patterns in data as well as the structure of the data. So when I say pattern, we are trying to understand if the data has some seasonality, if there is an increasing or decreasing trend in the data, if the data is stationary or non-stationary. These are all very important because once we get into the modeling part of it, lot of the underlying models have assumption of the data being linear or data being non-stationary. There are multiple factors comes into play. So it's very important we analyze the data. Not only that, the data may contain a lot of missing values. Now, in a typical world, we can substitute the missing value with the mean, median, or other techniques, or drop the data. But when it comes to time series data, now it's very important to understand the structure of data so that we can use the right imputation technique. We cannot drop the data because the order of the events that are happening in the time series world are very important to us. So we cannot have any missing event, while we can have in some modeling technique, but we try to retain the continuous events and see what is the right substitution techniques. So in this video, we will just do an analysis. We'll do an univariate analysis. We'll do a multivariate analysis. We will see autocorrelation plot. We will plots. We will see lag plots and everything, right? So let's get started. So the very first thing what I'm doing is I am installing a package called download. I'm going to use a data set that is there in the internet. So I'm just using the download package to download the data set. And so I have already installed the download package, and then I am typically installing the various libraries that we use for visualization. It can be your Seaborn, it can be your Matplotlib. I'm using Pandas. That is the data frame I'm going to use to load my data. And then Pandas also comes with some plotting library internally. I'm going to use that as well. So these are the different things I'm importing it. I'm just setting like default figure size so that I can visualize it better. Now you can change it to your need, or you can just remove it. So I just set this two parameters over here. Now what I'm using the download package I am installed, I am downloading the Beijing air quality data set from the UCI repository. So this is the link to that UCI repository. You can do a search for UCI Beijing air quality data set. I'm just downloading it. I'm downloading it into the temp-aq folder. AQ stands for air quality, and I'm telling it's a zip file. Right. So what it is going to do is it's going to download the data and it's going to unzip and keep it for me. So let me run this. It's going to download it and unzip for me. And then what I'm doing is I'm doing like a pandas read CSV. And then from the unzip, basically this zip file contains air quality for multiple location of China, of Beijing, multiple cities within Beijing, right? So what I'm doing is I am picking up only one city or county or whatever they call. It's called Dingling, and I'm doing an analysis. We can use other counties as well, but just for this purpose, I'm picking one of those. So that's what I'm done. The temp-aq is basically the target folder, and from there, like this is the folder structure that it creates, and I'm loading the CSV file. So let me load the CSV file. If you go and do an ls-art on that particular folder, this is the zip file name, and the folder is created by zip file name. You can see there are a lot of data set, air quality data set, depending on the different regions within Beijing. But I'm picking only one of it. I'm picking Dingling. You can pick anything out of it, right? And that's what I've given over here, right? The next thing is I'm just going to visualize the data. Right. Let us kind of understand the data because we are going to analyze it. So there are multiple variables. First is if you see the data, there's a year, month, day, hour as separate variables. So basically this time series data is basically at the hour level. So every hour, the different recordings over here, the different PM2.5, PM1.0 and SO2, NO2 are captured over here for every hour. So the data is basically ordered at time. Right, and this is the different variable. Now our target variable in this case is going to be PM2.5. So I'm going to analyze PM2.5. Let me talk about the different variables, your PM10 and PM2.5. Basically, the PM10 is basically a particulate matter, which is 10 micrometers or less in diameter. And PM2.5 is particulate matter, which is 2.5 micrometer or less in diameter, this PM2.5. Now, these are the key constituents of air quality. And what it means is basically it's an air pollutant that is concerned to many of the many of health conditions that are happening around the world. So if you see countries like Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, Indonesia, China, the PM2.5 pollutant is pretty high. These PM2.5 are very tiny particles that can stay in the air, and it can basically not only reduce the visibility in the environment, but it can also travel deeply into the respiratory tract, and it can basically cause short-term effects as well as long-term effects, conditions like asthma and heart disease. So that's why this PM2.5, if you see around the world, they try to keep it in control. But in some of the countries, it is pretty high and it causes very high health risk. So that's why we need to make sure that PM2.5 must be in control. At the same time, what we are doing here is we are just doing an analysis on this PM2.5 variable. But I'm going to use other variables as well. So the SO2 is basically sulfur dioxide. The NO2 is basically your nitrogen dioxide, your carbon dioxide. O3 is your ozone. And then you have your temperature, pressure, you have your dew point temperature, your rain, which is the precipitation, the wind direction, whether it's a east, north or east, northeast, and then the wind speed, and then the station. Station is what I told you I took it from. So these are the different columns that are available. Now we are also going to see in the univariate first, and then in multivariate, we are going to see effect of other variables with PM2.5. We are going to do all of those. Now, if you see on the top, the very first thing is I need to convert this data frame into more like time series order so that I can do better analysis of it. Now, if you see where the time is a combination of year, month, day and hour, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to combine it first. So for that, what I'm doing is, let me before that quickly print an info. And in the info, you can see basically you are all this variable are integer and float, and only the wind direction, which is nothing but a string variable, is an object, right? So the very first thing I'm doing is I am creating a function. In the function, I am basically taking the input data, which is different columns over here. It can be year, month, a day and hour. And then I am basically combining it for this format. Right, and in the pandas, I'm creating one more pandas data frame. I am assigning to aq_ef. I am again reading the file, and I am telling my date column, basically the past date. There is a function over there where I'm telling year, month, day, and hour are my variables, and I am calling this convert to date function that I have created on the top. So let me run this convert to date. I am calling this convert to date function that I have created on the top, and also I am telling the keep date column too. So if I give it false, what will happen? The granular data, year, month and day, hour will be removed, and you will have only one variable, which is a concatenated variable as year. But when I'm keeping it, I'm still keeping the other variables as well, apart from the concatenated variable, for me to do some analysis. So I'm keeping it true, but if you don't want it, you can just make it false. So let me run this and let me see the output. Now, if you see over here, I have got the first column, which is nothing but the concatenated column, year, month, day, hour. Then I have a number column. I don't need it. I can drop it. But for analysis, let's just keep it. We don't need it. But so I have the individual column also. As I said, if you make it false, you will not see these columns. And then I have all other data that I mentioned earlier. Right. Now, let me quickly do an info. And what you can see is the first column is a date time column, and then you have all other column as it is, right? So what I'm also going to do is I'm going to convert month into numeric, because I want to do some month level analysis, or I want to do some rolling on month. So I'm going to, the month over here is object over here. I'm going to convert that into in numeric value so that I can do an analysis. So I'm just doing a pandas.tonumeric and again assigning it to month. So let me quickly run how many rows are there, columns are there, how many features are there, and then we will see the output. So if you see on the top, we have around 35,064 columns. We third rows, we have 19 columns. And then the missing value, basically all the PM2.5, PM10, everything, the missing value is true. So there are a lot of missing value as well. And it also gives the unique value, how many unique values are there, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to first run the descriptive statistics. Now for time series data, the descriptive statistics for our variable, it may not be applicable, but I'm quickly running to see like if there is any large anomaly or something like that. A typical example is temperature. In the temperature, I'm seeing the minimum value is minus 16 and the maximum value is 41. So basically what I'm getting is the summer goes till 41 and it's pretty like kind of moderate hot. But the winter also is pretty high. It goes till minus 16 in Beijing, right? So we get an understanding of the distribution of data. Similarly, PM2.5 that I'm going to analyze, if you see the minimum value is 3, right? And the 50%, that is the median, is 41, but the maximum value is 881. That is completely very high towards, it can be an outlier, but typically the air quality can go that bad as well in Beijing and other countries, which I said like Bangladesh, Pakistan, India are also pretty bad. Some cities are pretty bad. So even though it looks like an outlier, we will see if that's a real outlier or it is just part of the data. We will see as we do further analysis. So we just get an idea of our data distribution. Similarly for other variables. What I'm going to do is I'm going to also make a copy of this particular data frame, because what I'm going to index this by the time data. So I'm just making a copy of it and assigning it to non-indexed over here. And then what I'm doing is in this data frame, in the main data frame, I'm setting index as the year, month, day, hour column. So when I set the main advantage of having an index is basically you can query it very fast. You can do a lot of subsetting and filtering of the data. So that is one advantage, and a lot of plots for time series requires this data to be indexed. So that's why I'm indexing it. So let me show you how it looks after the index. So once I index it, you can quickly run the index and you can see basically it contains all the timestamp. So think it like a database index. It makes your query very efficient and fast, and you can do a lot of subsetting of data also. You can use the pandas lock, that lock variable to locate a particular index value and easily pull it out, right? So this is how my output looks like after I index the data. You can see basically the columns are on the top and the indexed values on the left-hand side over here, and this the index values what we saw on the top. So now I have the data indexed. Now what I can do is I can quickly query. So if I want to pull the data between 01 March 2013 to 05 March 2013, I can just say aq underscore df dot locate lock, and then I can give this value. So you can see basically I got this 2 days of data. And if I want to like get data between 2 years, I can just say 2013 to 2015, and I can get the 2 year of data. Right. So basically, index makes it very convenient to do this kind of query. You can do it with the regular pandas function also, but it will not be as fast of this on large data set. That's the difference. It's not that you cannot do without index. You can do it. But as I said, some of the functions that you use for plotting takes this index data time as consideration to plot the data. Now, the very first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take only the PM2.5 out of the data frame, and I'm assigning to PM data, and I'm going to just quickly print few records. And you can see basically the data is time ordered, and then these are the different values. Let me do a plotting of the data. So what I'm doing is I'm doing the PM data, which contains only PM2.5. I'm telling plot. And then I'm just giving grid equal to 2 to get in the grid format. Now you can see I have data from actually 2013 to 2017. And you can basically see some spikes over here. While because I have a lot of data in the frame, it's crumbled. But at the beginning of the year, you can see spikes in PM2.5. And we saw like one of the value in PM2.5 that was 880 was the highest value. And you can see the spike over here. So every year there's spike in PM2.5, but I'm not able to visualize it properly. So what I can do is I can take only 1 year. So what I'm doing is instead of visualizing for all year, I am taking only 2015, and then I'm assigning it to a data frame. And then I'm taking the 2.5 variable, PM2.5 out of it, and then visualizing it. So this will show me data only for a year. Now, from this data, what you can see is during the January, February and March month, it is pretty high. And then it starts slowing down. And again, during October, November, December, it becomes pretty high. Right. So this is what we are seeing for 2015. But is this particular pattern repeating? Right. We saw on the top graph, it was kind of repeating. But let's individually view for 2016 as well. So here, what I'm doing is I'm taken 2016. I am doing the same thing and I am plotting it as above. And then here you can see in 2016, I can almost see a same pattern. Like Jan, Feb and March, it's high. April, it is coming down, not completely, but June, July, August, the PM2.5 is very less. And then it's again increasing. So basically, there is some seasonality to this PM2.5, right? It's pretty high during the October, November, December, Jan, Feb, March month. And then during June, July, August, September, it really comes down, right? And if you are from any of the countries like China, Beijing, China, Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, you know what happens during winter. And typically this is the winter season. So does it correlate to winter? We will see as we go down. But at least we get an intuition. Okay, there is some seasonality to the data, right? Now what I'm going to do? See, this was pretty, plotting it individually is pretty like tiresome, right? We don't want to do that. Is there a better way? I can create the plot as above, but I can go and do individual analysis, right? And for that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use Plotly Express. So here I am importing like Plotly Express. I'm going to now put it for all the data. So here I'm using the non-indexed one. I'm not using the indexed one. I'm drawing, basically create a line chart. That's what I'm doing. And then I am giving my x-axis as year, month, day and hour and y-axis as PM2.5. I'm just giving a title. So I'm going to create a slider, right? And that's what I'm giving on the bottom. I'm telling in this figure, update the x-axis with the range slider. Make it visible. I will run it and show it to you. So once you run it, now I'm getting the same graph as before for all the year, right? Now, if you see here, I'm getting for all the year. So it's not like you are able to see some spike in the beginning of January 2015 and again 16 and then like to 14, 15. Here you're able to see spike. But again, it's very lot of data points are fitting in a graph. So that's why this slider in the bottom is. This slider is basically, I can do a slider like this and I can narrow down and I can quickly visualize it. So rather than creating separate plot, I can use Plotly Express to kind of get to a particular point. I can visualize it. I can keep it on top of it. I can see, okay, here you can, this particular point, you can see 344. So here you have around 610, right? There are multiple things that you can do to visualize it. Here you have 881, which was the peak. So this gives me a better way of visualizing it. So rather than creating separate plot, so you can use this as well. Now, what I can do additionally, if you see typically a stock market data, right? On the top, you have 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, and can do that as well. Yes, I can do that. So I'm again going to Plotly Express, basically the same thing. I am again giving the same year, month, day, hour as my x-axis, y as PM2.5 as my y-axis. And then I am, what instead of giving only range slider to, I am also giving a dictionary where I am telling put me buttons. The first button is for 1 year, 2 year, 3 year. And I'm telling basically the step is here. If you want on month, make the step to month. If you want on day, make the step to day. And I'm telling the step mode is backward. You want backward 1 year or forward 1 year. You can give that option. And I'm also putting a step hall. So let me run this. And the graph will be pretty similar to the top, but you will also, if you see on the top, you have this button, right? Now with this, I have the slider as well in the bottom where I can play around, right? And then I can go on the top. I can select 1 year graph. I can select 2 years graph. So you get in 1 year graph, basically you're seeing I have data only from 2016. And then in the 2 year graph, you will have 2015 and 2016. I can do 3 year. I can play around the slider within that. So I can do a lot of analysis easily. So you can use Plotly Express also, right? I just want to show this functionality. The other good way will be to overlay two variables and see how it is. So what I can do is, rather than visualizing this 2014 and 2015 separately, can I overlay it above one another, right, with different colors and then see if the pattern is same, right? So that is one thing we can do as well. So in this case, what I'm doing is I'm creating two data frame 2014 and 2015. I am assigning both 2015 and 15, and here I am Now, when I do it at an hour level, right? So I may have a lot of data. So what I'm doing is I'm cutting down the hour. I'm applying a lambda function. I'm doing it at day level so that I have less data points, so that the data points are very well spread across. So what will happen? All the 24 hours data within a day will get aggregated to a day level, right? And I am creating two data frame over here. And then again, I'm plotting both of it, right? And if you see the output over here, in the plotting, you will see one overlaid over on the top. So here, if you see, like, you have 2014 in the blue color and 2015 in the orange color. And you can see basically 2014 and 2015 as similar spikes. And during the in-between month, because it's a day level, the x-axis is basically too crumbled. You can do it month level as well, but I just want to show it. So in the center, you can see basically it is reduced PM 2.5 and again it spikes up. So that is basically commonality between years, right? And that's a seasonality. That's what we are inferring from this. Now, what I can do is I can also like group it by month. So here what I'm doing is I'm taking the air quality data set, I'm grouping it with month, and then I'm running it describe. So here I'm selecting only PM 2.5. So I have month and PM 2.5. I am grouping it by month. I am taking all the PM 2.5. I am setting a lot of metrics over here. When I say describe, it will do a descriptive statistics, right, in Pandas. So that's what I am doing. So now in the month of January, my mean is 70. In February, 86. In March, 80. Then it comes down a little in April, and then it falls down during other months, and again it shoots up during October, right? So that's what you're seeing. Whatever we see on the saw on the graph, we are also seeing it in the descriptive statistics, and you can see min value 25%, 50%, 70% for the PM 2.5 value. So I'm just using a grouping function. What you can also do is you can select a particular year. I'm grouping my month, and I'm only getting max of PM 2.5, and then the temperature min and max. So what from univariate analysis of PM 2.5, I'm going into bivariate analysis, and instead of only using PM 2.5, I am using here temperature as well. So let me quickly run this. Now if you see on the top, what I'm doing is I have the PM 2.5 per month, I have aggregated per month, and I have the temperature minimum and maximum. And you can see during January, February, March, where the basically PM 2.5 is very high over here. Here I am seeing basically the temperature is going negative. So it's kind of winter, and the maximum is around 12, 14, 26. But as and when the maximum temperature increases during summer, you can see basically the PM 2.5 is lower. And again, when it goes to negative temperature and it kind of gets into spring or winter, you can see again the PM 2.5 increasing over here, right? So that is kind of the pattern you are seeing over here, right? Now, what I can do is I can plot it together. I can plot PM 2.5 and temperature together. So I'm going to take 2015 data, and then I'm going to plot it. And now you can see it better rather than in a table format. Now you can see like during the initial month, Jan, Feb and March, the temperature is pretty low. That means it's cold, and the PM 2.5 is higher. But as the temperature increases, the PM 2.5 is lower. And again, as it falls down, it increases. Right. So basically now we are able to correlate two graphs and then see like what is causing this PM 2.5. The PM 2.5 can be due to winter, but why should it go during winter? And that's where our business and domain understanding comes into play. So what I've done is I've attached an article which you can refer it. It's in weather.com. If you can search by this name, why do pollution levels skyrocket during winter? It's a very nice article which talks about PM 2.5, what is it, PM 10, what is it, what are the other components like nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide and everything, how do they come together? You can read this article. This is the link for it. Right. But I'm not going to go into detail of it. It's always good to understand when you are solving a problem, the business aspect of it. If you're doing a sales, retail sales, during Thanksgiving or during Christmas, the sales may skyrocket. So basically, there's a seasonality during that time. There can be a weekly seasonality as well. So having understanding of the domain really helps. Right. Now, what also I can do is I can do an historical histogram plot, right? So basically, I'm doing for both PM 2.5 and temperature. And in PM 2.5, you're seeing like most of the values are in the lower 0 to 50, and then 0 to 100. And in the as the values become higher, the frequency reduces, right? In the case of temperature, there is actually a bimodal distribution over here, or multimodal. It's a bimodal actually. You can see basically there is a spike during winter and there's a spike during summer. Right, in some of the modeling technique, the distribution matters, but you can work around with the distribution, which I'll talk in my future video how to do it. Right, so you just kind of get an idea of the histogram plot on how it looks like. I can also take the temperature data and plot the kernel density estimation. Basically, that's it, this showing that is a bimodal distribution over here. There are two spikes over here. Right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to do lag plot. And basically, what is a lag plot? Now, lag plot is a special type of scatter plot with where there are two variables. The x-axis is the current time. The y-axis is the lag period. By default, the lag period is 1. And when the lag period is 1, it is called a first order lag plot. When a lag period is 2, it's called a second order lag plot. Right? Now, let me run it and show you. Basically, the linear shape of the plot suggests that an autoregressive model is probably a better choice. Now, lag plot can be used in multiple scenarios. You can check linearity, you can check outliers, you can check randomness, you can check whether there's a serial correlation or autocorrelation. I'll show you one by one. Right? Now, we know our data is basically hourly. Right? So, let me run a lag of one on the temperature. If you take a temperature, basically my current temperature will have correlation with 1 hour back temperature. The temperature does not like very dynamically rise every hour. In some countries it might, but most of the time it's not. And you can see over here there is a very linear relationship with 1 hour lag. So if the x-axis is say like 12 o'clock, my y-axis will be basically your 11 o'clock, right? So I'm doing with a lag of one, right? Now, what I'm doing is when I increase to lag of 10, so lag of 10 is 10 hours because my data is hourly, it will be 10 hours, right? So between 10 hours, there may be change in some variation. You can see basically if you draw a center line over here, the data is not as linear as above. So we know when it's 10 hours, the temperature may be different. So you get an idea whether the data is linear or not. And why do we need lag plot? So when you are going to correct and a trend or stationary, you may have to kind of do some smoothing functions, and the lag plot really helps us understand the data better, right? Now that's what it is. But when I go for 24 hours, typically my temperature at the time will be same as what it was yesterday most of the time, right? Even when the season changes, it's not a gradually increases. And you can see basically here the data is again spread but towards the center, not as correlated as the 1 hour plot, but it's still correlated. So as the points are towards the center, you can find more correlation. As it is away, you can find the correlation reduces. Now that is the lag is nothing but it's called like an autocorrelation. So when you talk about correlation, we compare two variables, and that's why we use Pearson or Spearman correlation. But when we talk about autocorrelation, it's basically the correlation within itself. Right, you take time data t minus 1 or t plus 1, whatever it is, and you're trying to correlate the data within itself, and that's why it's called autocorrelation. Now, a positive linear trend, right? This shows there's a positive linear trend, but there can be a negative trend as well. Basically, if the data is going from bottom left to top right, but it can also go from top left to bottom right. That is linear. And if the data is accumulated towards the center of it, there is no correlation at all. So let me show that plot as well, right? So now what I'm doing is I'm going and comparing this data with lag 8640. Now lag 8640 is nothing but 1 year. Like, so I have 24 data points per day, and I have 365 days a week. 365 days a year. So 365 into 24 is 8640. And when I run this, my data should be correlated to the previous year, right? So you can still see there is some correlation. You can still see there is some correlation over here. There is some positive correlation. The data is spread out, but still it is centered, right? Now, if you come down, when I do for 4320, that is 6 months. So now it's winter, 6 months, it can be summer. So let's see if there's a correlation. So when I run this, you can see there's a negative correlation. In the top, you are seeing the data is coming from bottom to top, but here it's coming from the top left to the bottom right. There is some negative correlation because the temperature changes, right, between summer to winter, but there is still some negative correlation. Now, the same thing what I can do is I can run for lag 2150. 2150 is 3 months. Now, within 3 months, it is not even winter or summer. It's like intermediary, right? So let me see how it looks like. If you see the data is actually forming a donut in the center, and this shows there is no correlation at all, right? So in time series, autocorrelation is very important. There are a lot of ACF plots and PACF plots, which we will look at as we go into the next video. But here, lag is one quick way of getting the information. And here you see there is no correlation at all. If you draw a line, basically the data is completely spread out. Right, so that is here. You can also check for outlier. If you have points completely outside of it, you can also check for outlier. Now let's go for bivariate to multivariate. Right, earlier we plotted only temperature and PM 2.5. let me add pressure also to it. Right, let's see how does the air pressure correlate. So I'm taking again the 2015 data on top and then running it. Now you can see basically the air pressure here as a negative correlation to your temperature. So if the temperature increases, the pressure comes down, right? So basically you're trying to visualize patterns in multiple variables, right? Now you may skip some variables because there's already some correlation. Sometimes when you're doing for multiple time series, you may want to plot multiple output variables as well, which I will cover as I go into detail in few of the next video. Now what I'm doing is I am plotting other variables as well. I'm taking temperature, pressure, basically rain, your PM 2.5, your dew point temperature, everything I'm taking, I'm just plotting it. Now here if you see, over here, now where basically the PM 2.5 and the rain typically is towards the summer. There's no correlation between this. So basically they are mutually exclusive. Rain comes during the winter, the PM 2.5, so rain is during the summer months and the PM 2.5 is during the winter. But the PM 2.5 has a correlation with the pressure. You can see it increases as the pressure increases, and when the pressure increases, the temperature decreases. Right, that's what you're seeing over here. I can also plot it with the other variables, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen dioxide, the ozone, the carbon dioxide and everything. And you can see basically the carbon and the PM 2.5 as correlation, whereas the ozone and this one does not have any correlation, right? You can see the output. Now, what I can also do is I can basically try to plot your PM 2.5 and O3, and you can see they are mutually exclusive. In the top, you saw like O3 is high during the summer month, whereas PM 2.5 is high during the winter month. And here you can see the same pattern when I'm overlaying one above the other, where your O3 is higher and during the month, where PM 2.5 is less, whereas PM 2.5 is high, the O3 is less, right? So you're just like correlating the graphs. Okay? Now, let me go back to my 2015 PM 2.5. If you see the top, right, when I print the PM 2.5, I see a lot of null values. Now, one thing is the time series need to be continuous. I can drop these variables, but if I drop it, then the continuity in the time data is gone. So I need to see like how I can impute it. Let me do some further analysis and see more details when I print the 2015 data frame. I can see not only PM 2.5, but PM 10, SO2, NO2, all is null. Maybe at that time the sensor did not work and everything, the data was not captured. There can be multiple problems to that time, right? Now let me check for null values. I can check if there is a null value in the data frame, that is, and if that is, which are all the null values. You can see all this output are null values. I can also do a sum and see how many null values are there. You can see the temperature, pressure, dew point has around 50 odd null values, but the PM 2.5, PM 10, as around 700 odd null values. The SO2 and NO2 has 1000 plus null values, right? NO2 and carbon were null points. I can do a par plot to see a correlation. It's a regular correlation. It is not an autocorrelation. I am just doing a correlation between two different variables. So the par plot will give me the correlation. So now if you take only with PM 2.5, then you can see basically SO2 does not have much correlation. NO2 has some correlation. CO has a lot of correlation. So you can see the graph. What I can do is I can also run a Pearson correlation on it. And you can see basically with PM 2.5, CO has 0.80. So the correlation between -1 to +1, the more it towards the positive one, it is a positive correlation. The more towards the negative one, it's a negative correlation. If it is around 0, there is no correlation at all. So that is a strong correlation. Similarly, with NO2, there is some strong correlation. With SO2, there is some decent correlation. I can also generate an heat map, correlation heat map, to visualize it better. So that's what I'm doing. The top, what I'm doing is I'm generating a heat map. I'm using the SNS plot, and then I'm generating heat map to see. The more it is red, it is highly correlated. Otherwise, it's kind of mild correlation. Depending on the color, it's a heat map. You can see the correlation. As if you see 0.48, it's light red, whereas the other two is dark red. So there's more correlation. Now, what I can do is I can come back and continue with my other variables. Does wind direction, is there a correlation of wind direction to my PM 2.5 or my other temperature variable? So here I'm only taking like the PM 2.5. What I'm doing is with the wind direction, does the PM 2.5 increases? So when it's east, it's around like 70. When it's east northeast, it's 56. But when it's north, northeast, east and all, the PM 2.5 median is very less. Right. Even the mean, if you see, is very less. So maybe when the wind is doing the east direction, it may be higher. So you are just trying to take all the variable and correlate it. Right. So that's what I'm doing over here. Now, finally, what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about basically autocorrelation plot. And for that, what I'm doing is I am taking a copy of it. I'm dropping NA. Typically, I don't want to do drop and null variable. But in this, for this purpose, just to show autocorrelation plot, I'm going to drop it. This is just an analysis side of it. But once I know what to impute the data with, based on my autocorrelation part, I may go and impute it. For now, first I will drop it, and then I will do an basically I'm using the pandas plotting autocorrelation plot. And what I'm telling is, in the autocorrelation plot, I am basically giving between 2014 to 2016 data. Which is the which with the null removed, and I'm giving the temperature variable. Right? Now, see the if this autocorrelation, if you see, it is just a similar to a correlation measure, right? And it tells whether there's a linear relationship between two variables. Now, autocorrelation in this case, what it does is it measures the linear relation between the lagged value of the time series. So down, if you see, there's a lag value. Since my data is hourly, right? It shows the lag value in hour. So it is 5,000, 10,000 lag, 15,000 lag, and 20,000 lag. And if you see on top, my data, if I'm zero, it's a positive. And then again, it becomes positive around 8,500. And we know on a hourly data, 8,500 is exactly 1 year, right? It's 24 data points per day into 365. So every year, you can see basically the data follows a pattern. There is some seasonality over here. But so many lags are difficult to visualize. So can we condense the data in kind of a monthly format so that I can visualize it better, right? So that's what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my temperature data. That's a resample method in your pandas data frame. I'm going to use the resample method. I'm going to tell resample for 1 month. If I give 1Y, it's going to be 1 year. If I give 1D, it's going to be 1 day. But what I'm doing is I'm resampling for 1 month and taking a mean. So the output will look like this because I'm doing monthly. From hourly data, the hour is gone over here. Right? Now I have like all the months. I have the March 2013, April 2013. I have May 2013. So I have resampled it to 1 month and my aggregation is mean. So that's what I'm doing on top. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this and then pass it to my autocorrelation plot. And I'm going to tell resample for 1 month. So instead of passing only the granular data, which is hourly, I am telling resample for 1 month and show me the mean. Now, if you see this autocorrelation part, basically shows us a better view of it. You can see every 12, right? Every 12, there's a peak. That is every year. There are 12 months in a year. So it starts zero. Every 12 months, there's a peak 12. And then again, there's a peak 24. And then again, 36. These two lines are the confidence interval, right? So basically, this shows the autocorrelation strength, right? Now, this is a 90%, 90% the strong lines are 90% confidence interval, and the dotted lines are 95% confidence interval. So basically, the more towards it to the 90-95%, it shows the strength of the relationship, right? Now, and as you are computing for further lag, it is bound to get reduced, right? Because as the lag increases, maybe the autocorrelation also will increase in many cases, right? Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do the same thing for the PM 2.5 variable and see how it looks like. Now, in the PM 2.5, now everything is within the 90 confidence interval band. That does not mean there's no autocorrelation, right? Maybe the strength of the autocorrelation is less compared to it. So here, if you see again, there's a positive trend and the positive trend again in 12. So basically, there is a seasonality, there is some kind of correlation. So with all this plot, what you are trying to understand is how your time series data is better represented. What is the structure of it? What is the pattern of your data? Whether there is a trend, whether there's a seasonality. Here we didn't see any trend. Basically everything was centered around mean. But sometimes if you think like the PM 2.5 every year keeps on increasing, right? Then you can see the data moving rather than constant in mean. It will go above the mean and move upwards. That's why the trend is there. I will take some examples of trend in the next video and we will do some analysis on top of it. But in this video, I just want to purely focus on time series analysis, exploratory data analysis, the statistical techniques behind it, and how to plot it, how to understand it, right? Half of the time series problem can be solved by proper data analysis, right? In the next video, I will be talking about some of the pandas function, like you have the rolling function, rolling average, rolling mean. So I will talk about it. I'll also talk about null value imputation. But that's it for this video. Thank you very much.